Good morning. Welcome to worship this morning. As you can see, everything is now blue. Blue is Advent, right? One of my favorite colors of the year. So we begin a new church year today, and we'll kick off our Advent season today. Also, we're still going through the story, so we're in chapter 12, so now we're in King David. King David is picked by not humans, but by God to be king over Israel. So we'll dive into chapter 12 today. So we have the worship team here this morning, and let's jump right into our first song for worship. I invite you to stand as you are able. We begin our worship this morning in the name of the Father, and the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. Father, when we confess the wrongs we've done, you assure us we are made clean. Our sins are forgiven, and you remember our sins no more. Let us then confess our sins to God our Father. Most merciful God, we confess that we are by nature sinful and unclean. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sins I've committed against you, Father, please forgive me. For the sins I've committed against others, Father, please forgive me. For the sins I've left undone when I failed to follow your commandments, Father, please forgive me. For the sins only you and I know that I have committed, Father, please forgive me. For these sins and all others that you know I have committed, I justly deserve your present and eternal punishment. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on me. Forgive me, renew me, and lead me, so that I may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. God hears our confession. In Jesus, his Son paid the price on the cross to take away our guilt, shame, and sin. As a called and ordained servant of the word, I therefore can once again tell you of the grace of God given to each of you. And in the stead and by the command of my Lord Jesus Christ, I forgive all your sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, you are forgiven. Go in peace. Amen. You may be seated.
The Old Testament for the first Sunday in Advent is from 1 Samuel chapter 16. The Lord said to Samuel, "How long will you grieve over Saul, since I have rejected him from being king over Israel? Fill your horn with oil and go. I will send you to Jesse the Bethlehemite, for I have provided for myself a king among his sons." When they came, he looked on Eliab and thought, "Surely the Lord's anointed is before him." But the Lord said to Samuel, "Do not look on his appearance or the height of his stature, because I have rejected him. For the Lord sees not as man sees. Man looks on the outward appearance, but the Lord looks on the heart." Then Jesse said to Abinadab, then Jesse called Abinadab and made him pass before Samuel. And he said, "Neither has the Lord chosen this one. Then Jesse made Shammah pass by, and he said, "Neither has the Lord chosen this one." And Jesse made seven of his sons pass before Samuel. And Samuel said to Jesse, "The Lord has not chosen these." Then Samuel said to Jesse, "Are all your sons here?" And he said, "There remains yet the youngest, but behold, he is keeping the sheep." And Samuel said to Jesse, "Send and get him, for we will not sit down till he comes here." And he sent and brought him in. Now he was ruddy and had beautiful eyes and was handsome. And the Lord said, "Arise, anoint him, for this is he." Then Samuel took the horn of oil and anointed him in the midst of his brothers, and the Spirit of the Lord rushed upon David from that day forward. And Samuel rose up and went to Ramah. This is the word of the Lord. The epistle is from Romans chapter 13. "Besides this, you know the time, that the hour has come for you to wake from sleep, for salvation is nearer to us now than when we first believed. The night is far gone, the day is at hand. So then let us cast off the works of darkness and put on the armor of light. Let us walk properly as in the daytime, not in orgies and drunkenness, not in sexual immorality and sensuality, not in quarreling and jealousy, but put on the Lord Jesus Christ and make no provision for the flesh to gratify its desires." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please stand as you're able for the reading of the Holy Gospel. The Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew, the 21st chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. Now when they drew near to Jerusalem and came to Bethpage, to the Mount of Olives, then Jesus sent two disciples, saying to them, "Go into the village in front of you, and immediately you'll find a donkey tied and a colt with her. Untie them and bring them to me. If anyone says anything to you, you shall say, 'The Lord needs them,' and he will send them at once." This took place to fulfill what was spoken by the prophet, saying, "Say to the daughter of Zion, behold, your king is coming to you, humble and mounted on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a beast of burden." The disciples went and did as Jesus had directed them. They brought the donkey and the colt and put on them their cloaks, and he sat on them. Most of the crowd spread their cloaks on the road, and others cut branches from trees and spread them on the road. And the crowds that went before him and that followed him were shouting, "Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest." And when he entered Jerusalem, the whole city was stirring up, saying, "Who is this?" And the crowd said, "This is the prophet Jesus from Nazareth of Galilee." This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. You may be seated. Lord, I ask that you speak through me this morning. Lord, may the words that come from my mouth give honor to you and your holy word. Please guide me with your words to send and equip this flock to grow your family and show your love. I ask all of this in the name of our crucified Savior who died and rose for our sins. Amen. Hello, friends. So it's Advent. Today we begin anew. Just like the Husker football team, right? Got a new coach this morning. But this is different. This is better. We begin the new church year with Advent. The word Advent comes from the Latin word coming. Advent is a time where we're waiting in eager anticipation for an important guest. Advent is time for us as Christians as we prepare for our coming King. He is the most important guest we have ever welcomed into this world. Jesus, God incarnate, God in the flesh, he's going to dwell among us and give us the greatest gift that has ever been given to mankind. Well, Advent begins. The church year begins. We begin with Jesus' earthly life. And we begin where his life began. It's probably why you're wondering, it's like, why are we reading Palm Sunday in Advent? We're not reading it because of the events of Palm Sunday. We're reading because that's the prophecy, one of the prophecies of Jesus that was fulfilled in the Old Testament. After Advent comes Christmas, which is about his birth. Then we have Epiphany, about his miracles and his ministry. Then we move into Lent, about his journey to the cross, his Calvary-bound mission. Then we have Easter, the resurrection and the sending of the apostles. And then 40 days later, he ascends to heaven. And then we have Pentecost, with the sending of the Holy Spirit. So the first year, half of the church year, approximately December through June, focuses on the life of Christ. The second half of the church year, approximately June through November, focuses on the teachings of Christ. So as I said, Advent specifically focuses on Christ's coming as we wait. So today, we're in chapter 11 of the story, and we're way before Jesus comes along. In fact, we're 28 generations before Jesus and 1,000 years before his birth. God will choose his first earthly king to rule over his people through Samuel. Remember last week in chapter 11, Samuel chose Saul to be king in chapter 10. But David, a man after God's own heart, will be chosen by God to rule over his people. As we read chapter 11, David is the most unlikely in the eyes of the people to lead them. Yet he is chosen by God. We read in chapter 10, Saul was tall, stood ahead among everyone else, and was good looking. He stood out in the crowd. Saul was the man that everybody wanted to follow. But David was a shepherd boy. And it says he was ruddy. Ruddy meaning he was this red, freckle-faced little kid. And he was cute. He was a cute little red-headed kid. See, Saul has been rejected by God to be king over Israel. And now he sends out Samuel once again to find a new king. But this time it's going to be different. This time God is going to choose the man who will be king. So Samuel comes to the house of Jesse. And if you remember, Jesse is the grandson of Boaz and Ruth. He's looking for the next king of Israel as directed by God. So Jesse brings out 7 of his sons. And God passes on all of them. Samuel asks, "Do you have any more sons?" He says, "Yeah, I got one more. Cute little David, the red-headed kid, freckle face. But he's not here. He's out. He's not even in the house. He's out tending the flock, showing us just how much his father thought of David being king." When David arrives, God tells Samuel, "Arise, anoint him, for this is he." Imagine the reaction of Samuel, of Jesse, and the brothers. "David? Are you kidding me? David, the cute little freckle-faced boy." Imagine the reaction of David. "Me? God says I'm meant to be king? There has got to be something wrong." But we have already seen in our journey through this story, God choosing people who we don't think are worthy. Not only that, those that are chosen didn't feel worthy. We look no farther than the examples of Moses and Gideon. So as Samuel is reviewing the sons of Jesse as instructed by God, he thinks that one of the other brothers is king because of his appearance and features. But God told Samuel, "Do not look on his appearance or on the height of his stature, because I have rejected him. For the Lord sees not as man sees. The man looks on the outward appearance, but the Lord looks on the heart. God had already chosen David because of his heart. To our standards and to the world's, David was the last person anyone thought should be king. But to God, David was the one. No doubt about it. And I was thinking about professional sports. When an athlete goes from playing in college to playing professionally, they have all these tests that they put them through, you know? They want to see how they score on these tests. Football, you get measured by strength and agility and speed. Baseball players are measured on hitting and base running and throwing and fielding. Each year, I don't care which sport you select, there are stories of athletes that have been passed over because of their testing scores. You see, they didn't pass the eye test. But now, they are successful athletes. On the other hand, there's been athletes that everybody says guaranteed to be a success because they hit all those benchmark testing. They scored higher than anybody else. And they passed the eye test. So they draft them first. They give them a whole bunch of money. And they're a flop. They're a failure. What's the one thing that teams can't test? They can't test the heart of an athlete, can they? They can't get inside of his chest and measure the determination, the focus, and what makes his heart beat. But God can measure the heart. And God knows the heart of each and every person. He knows each person's wants. He knows what makes your heart tick. He knows what others cannot test and understand about the heart. God knows the heart of each and every one of us. He knows the trials, the hurts, the pains. He also knows the joy, the excitement, the hope our hearts have. And God knows where our contentment lies. Does it lie in the things of this world or in Him? Like if most of us were honestly answer that question, it's a constant struggle between the two. Are we in a position of power, only use it to feed ourselves and get the things of the world that we want? You know, I think about if I had some very powerful people in the world, take some of the most powerful people all throughout the world. So I mean, so you could ask them one question. I would ask them this. What gives you contentment? What gives you contentment? I bet they'd have a hard time answering that question. Because I'm not sure if they know where true contentment is. Because they always seem to be chasing the next thing. They're always looking to get more power. They're always looking how to get one more dollar in their bank account. But David, young David, his heart is content. His heart is content as a man after God's own heart. So young David is anointed to be king, but it's going to be 14 years before David is king. And Saul, the first king, doesn't want to give up the throne. So David goes to serve under Saul. But things start to change when the Israelites go looking for a man to go to battle with Goliath, a champion of the Philistine army. See, the Israelites and the Philistines have been in battle against each other over the Promised Land. The Israelites know that the Philistines are going to be hard to defeat, especially when they have men like Goliath. There's been different estimations, but some estimate that Goliath was 9 feet tall or just over. He had armor that weighed more than David did, wringing wet, put it that way. Every day, Goliath comes out to challenge Israelites. He does it for 40 straight days. Goliath tempts and bullies the Israelites to send someone over to defeat him. Each day, the Israelites just look at each other and wonder, who's going to defeat this man? Because if the Philistines have Goliath, there's no way we can win. So just by chance, David is sent out into the battlefield one day where the Philistines and the Israelites are fighting. We read this. As he, David, talked with them, behold, the champion, The Philistine of Gath, Goliath by name, came up out of the ranks of the Philistines and spoke the same words as before, and David heard them. David feels immediately called by God to accept the challenge. David said, "The Lord who delivered me from the paw of the lion and the paw of the bear will deliver me, and from the hand of this Philistine, Goliath." And Saul said to David, "Go, and the Lord be with you." When Goliath hears this, he's none too humored. In fact, he's insulted because this little, cute, freckle-faced boy approaches Goliath to fight. And David put his hand in the bag and took out a stone. And he slung it and struck the Philistine in the forehead. The stone sank into his forehead and he fell on his face on the ground. See, having testified to his faith in God, David made short work of Goliath. David didn't deliver the Israelites from the Philistines. God did. God is the true deliverer of his people. The victory that David predicted demonstrated to all the world, once again, the existence and the power of God. They know from their ancestors the parting of the Red Sea that led their Israelites out of Egypt. And now they see with their very own eyes, once again, little David defeating Goliath. Because why? God has always been on a pursuit to win the hearts of the Israelites and deliver them to the land that he promised them. You think about it, through all their complaining and their discouragement, they worshiped false gods. They even rejected God that we read about last week. But God didn't leave his people. He continued to pursue them and deliver them. And God is not stopping there. Our God is not done. You know, we love the story of an underdog, don't we? We love stories like David and Goliath. We teach them to our kids when they're very little. When a heavy favorite falls to a lesser known, we love that story. Especially when it looks like the lesser known has no chance to win. We love these stories, especially in sports. The biggest upset in sports history was probably the Miracle on Ice, 1980. Al Michaels said those famous words, "Do you believe in miracles? Do you believe in miracles?" The heavily favored Russians went down in defeat that day. The lives of those hockey players and their coach changed in a big way. Each player became a household name. And for David, things are about to change in a big way. So much so, King Saul becomes jealous of David to the point where he wants David dead. It says in Scripture that Saul was afraid of David because the Lord was with him but had departed from Saul. You see, the stories of these two men, Saul and David, are going in completely different directions. Saul was the once powerful king, but he didn't follow the direction of God as he was told by Samuel. He's now a mess, and he's struggling to make sense of it all. Scripture tells us that Saul became paranoid and unstable as the days went on. So much so that his own family preferred David over Saul. So he's reading that Saul is consumed by anger and jealousy. And on numerous occasions, he tried to kill David, because David was a threat. Saul's heart had become hard. See, Saul could see the end coming, but he didn't want it to come. And he's not going to let go of the crown without a fight. David, on the other hand, is going viral, isn't he? Everybody's talking about him because he killed Goliath. And on top of that, he helped the Israelites win many battles. The people sang of his feast, singing, "David has slain tens of thousands." On top of that, David had won the hand of the daughter of King Saul. He didn't have to pay any taxes for the rest of his life for defeating Goliath. David was a poet and a musician. He wrote many of the psalms we have in Scripture. David was a man after God's own heart. David is faithful to God, and God gives him successes. David has his entire life in front of him. He's anointed to be king, a king God chose for his people. But remember this, keep this in the back of your mind for next week. David, that cute little kid, is not perfect. We're going to see it next week in chapter 12. But for today, we see David. He's in training to be king. And as he's in training, he's going to use three people to prepare David to be king. Samuel and Jonathan and Nathan. First is Samuel. He's a mentor for David. See, Samuel has a wealth of knowledge. He was raised by Eli, the high priest. He's a source of wisdom and knowledge for David. When David needs advice and guidance, he goes to Samuel. David also knows that Samuel is a man after God's own heart. He trusts him. Jonathan is a friend of David, also Saul's son. Every man needs a friend, a true friend who they can trust, who they can talk to, who they can relate to, who they have something in common with. Jonathan, the son of Saul, was being groomed by Saul to be king, but Jonathan knew David would be the next king. Jonathan helped David. He protected David and listened to David when he needed a friend. And Nathan holds David accountable. We'll see more of this next week in chapter 12. Nathan's a trusted person in David's life. He comes forward and holds David accountable when David does things that are not what a man after God's own heart would do. You see, holding someone accountable, especially a person like David who is king, could have some dire consequences. But God put Nathan in David's life to hold him accountable. God brought Samuel and Jonathan and Nathan into David's life to help prepare him to be king. You see, God put people in our lives to help prepare us and lead us. In this journey of life, when we're young, we have this whole life in front of us, we are told, go chase your dreams. Don't let anyone tell you it can't be done. So we move through life, and everything seems to be going pretty well, and then there's a setback, an unexpected event. Or we get up one day of living our lives, and we start to wonder, there's got to be more than life than this. There has to be more to life than this. Maybe it's just the stage of life that I'm in, but there seems to be many men who have achieved the world's successes in life, but they're empty. They're alone, and they're wandering. They have very little or no contentment in their life. Because we all need mentors. We all need friends. We need people to hold us accountable. I can almost guarantee you the stories of any men that we've seen fall in a very public way, they didn't have true mentors. They didn't have true friends, and they didn't have people that held them accountable. Especially people that held them accountable. Because they're king of their world, and nobody tells them no. You see, God put people like Samuel and Jonathan and Nathan in the life of David, a man who he appointed to be king himself. So as you think about it, who is your Samuel? Who's your Jonathan? Who's your Nathan? Who is your mentor? Who is your friend? Who is your accountability person in your life? It's just like David, we're not perfect, are we? We must surround ourselves with people who have the same heart that we do. It's been captured by God. Through our experiences, God has prepared us. Because not all of our experiences are going to be what we want. There's going to be a Goliath in your life. But God prepares us in this lower story to be a part of his upper story. And as he does, he knows we can't do it on our own. All throughout Scripture, we see men and women who are mentors and friends and accountability people. If you don't have a mentor, a true friend, or accountability person in your life, look around for someone who could be. Look around for someone who could be your Samuel, your Jonathan, or your Nathan. And then be intentional. Look for a time to get together and have those true open conversations and be vulnerable. Be open, be honest. That's what we see David did. And remember, my door is always open. I'm a phone call or text away. Because this lower story that we read today in chapter 11 of young David, provides for us a wonderful example of how God grants victory in the face of impossible odds. But we know the stories don't always end that way, do they? You see, this story anticipates Jesus' victory on the cross for us. Jesus' victory in the face of all the powers that were against him. Because we're not to place our trust in human endeavors or devices or even ourselves or the successes that David had. The message of the cross is that God chose what is weak to be strong. So as we begin this new year, this Advent season, we're preparing again for the arrival of our King. Jesus, our King, is greater than any earthly king. Amen? Amen? Let us pray. And may the peace that surpasses all understanding be with us all. Amen. This time the ushers will come forward and collect the tithes and the offerings. Thank you. invite you to please rise as you're able. As Christians, we confess what we believe in the words of the Nicene Creed. I ask you, Christian, what do you believe? I believe in one God, Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, whom for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary and was made man and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried. The third day he rose again according to the Scriptures and ascended to heaven and sits at the right hand of the Father. And he will come again with glory to judge both the living and the dead, whose kingdom will have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, whom with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Let us pray for the whole church of God in Christ Jesus, and for all people according to their needs. God, we continue to thank you for making your story our story. You pursued all of us, each one of us, your children, are given a part of the greatest story of all time, a story that redeems us and gives us each the gift of eternity with you. Please guide us and guard us as you always do, as we seek more and more to know your story for each one of us. Lord, in your mercy, and Lord, this Advent season, we wait in eager anticipation once again. We ask that you would continue to guide us and lead us as you always do. May we seek the contentment found only in you. Lord, in your mercy. And Lord, today we bring before you the family of Dan Dawson, son-in-law of Joan and John Strobley. Dan passed from this earth to your loving arms this past week after a courageous battle with cancer. We ask that you surround the family and friends of Dan this week as they grieve their loss and also remind them of the hope of eternity with you. Lord, in your mercy, Lord, we thank you for the calling you give missionaries all over the world. We pray especially today for Barbara Bentish and Pastor Stephen Oliver and family serving in Taiwan, Pastor Rickman and family serving in Latin America. We also pray for the staff of Lighthouse Projects in the Dominican Republic. We pray that in every nation, there would be people who hear the word of God through your missionaries. Lord, in your mercy, and Lord, we thank you for this church. We thank you for the people who have made this building of Church of Believers, who praise you and know Jesus as their Savior. Let us continue to focus on our mission statement, growing God's family, showing God's love. We pray that we would reflect the light of Christ in this community and throughout the entire world. We ask that all who come through our doors are shown the love of Christ. Lord, in your mercy. Lord, today we pray for those who suffer physically, emotionally, and spiritually. We name before you today Ron, Dan, Elaine, Gay, Fern, Donna, Darcy, Lloyd, Chad, Diana, James, Caleb, Shane, Bob, Mike, Sally, Lois, Shirley, Tom, Teresa, and those we name personally at this time. We also continue to pray for all caregivers and all others who tend to the sick and hurting. We ask that you would give relief and care to their pain and illness according to your will. Lord, in your mercy, all these things. Whatever else you know that we need, grant us, Father, for the sake of him who died and rose again and now lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. We boldly pray together the prayer our Lord and Savior taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Receive the blessing of the Lord. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord looks upon you with his favor, and he gives you his peace. Amen. You may be seated. Announcements for you this morning to focus on, and one just reminded me that I didn't put the Advent devotionals out. So, as soon as church is over, I'm going to go grab them out of my office. But we have Advent devotionals for you that they'll start, I think they start December 1st, and they're based on our theme for Wednesday night services, This Is My Son. It's just got like a day, kind of like the portal prayer, a daily devotion for you to read through as we prepare for Christmas this season. After 10:30 service today, we'll put the big Christmas tree up, so if you want to come back and help out with that, I'm not sure we'll have people at 10:30 service. It doesn't usually take very long to get that up. Sandy appreciates the help. couple announcements for Christmas. Make sure you note that this week we start Advent services on Wednesday night. They're at 7 o'clock. 7 o'clock is our Advent services. And then Christmas caroling will be next Sunday. So if you'd like to come, sign up, go make a joyful noise for some of our shut-ins and care facilities, and then we'll come back here for fellowship and some food. And then also, I know the social ministry, I haven't, but we do have families that we are adopting. It's going to be in the newsletter exactly what items we're going to need that each family's requesting for Christmas, so we'll have a list of those to get out to you for that. Christmas poinsettias. Order forms are out for those also, so all kinds of Christmas announcements and stuff that's coming up. It's going to come very quickly. For me, the men's quarterly breakfast is going to be on December 10th. It's a Saturday morning. It's from 8 to 11 down at the fellowship hall, so just come for a time of breakfast. Doesn't matter age. Come hang out with us. We'll have a devotion also that morning and time together, and some, I'll promise, we'll have bacon. Do the ladies have bacon?
No. Are you coming to make it?
Maybe.
Yes, but the ladies' event is this Saturday. That's hard to believe. December 3rd, 9 to 11. I hope you can all make it. Like I said, got some fun stuff planned, and then we'll also talk about joy.
Any other announcements? Oh, 2 weeks from today is the voters' meeting. That's what I want to make sure I said. The voters' meeting is 2 weeks from today. Annual voters meeting, so we'll have one service 9 o'clock, and then the voters meeting to a follow immediately after that. So I'll make sure we get that announced and out to everybody else. Any other announcements this morning? Go in peace.
And serve the Lord.
I'm gonna go get the Advent devotional, so I'm going this way. All right, I'll meet you at the back door.